ocean acidification. Are coral reefs going to dissolve or at least grow a lot more slowly? All that extra carbon dioxide in the atmosphere goes into the ocean, makes the ocean more acidic. Actually, it's not, but we'll go into that in a little bit. And all those little critters that grow calcium carbonate skeletons like coccolithophores and foraminiferas and bivalves and gastropods, they're all in deep trouble. But who cares about those little slimy little critters? We really need something that's furry and cute with big eyes like a koala. Hey, Leonard, koalas, if you stick them in acid, do they dissolve? Apparently they do, but they don't live in the ocean, so we need something else. How about a coral reef? They're beautiful. All the little fish around them are nice and colourful. People can get all emotionally attached to that. And so it is that the scientists have been warning for quite a while that the effect of the ocean acidification is going to kill the coral reefs. Now, we actually did a video on this, how there was a huge claim about the Great Barrier Reef was already slowing down growth here. And you'll find if you look at that, that actually they made a huge mistake and the Great Barrier Reef is doing fine. But today I want to look at the basic chemistry and this claim that the pH is like the acidity or the basidity of the ocean, and why there's actually a huge problem with the whole theory of why this might be a problem. Now, I have to confess I was ignorant about a lot of the recent research until just until the last couple of months. We had quite a bit of our work, my research work, quoted in the Department of Energy report in the United States by the five scientists who basically wrote a huge report saying that climate change is not a huge deal. And because of that, we had to dig in a little bit of detail. And it turns out that a lot of these threats to the Great Barrier Reef, well, like the temperature rise is really a good thing for the Great Barrier Reef. And even though I worried about the pH thing a few years ago, it doesn't look like it's a problem. So we'll have a look at it. It turns out that when you put extra carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, some of that dissolves into the ocean, but it just doesn't dissolve. It also reacts with the water. And so there ends up being three forms, if you like, of this carbon dioxide. One is the actual carbon dioxide dissolved molecules. Then there's the carbonate ion, which is like a carbon dioxide with an extra oxygen. And then there's a bicarbonate ion, which is the carbon dioxide with an extra hydrogen and an oxygen. And those three forms are what you've got in the ocean. And the relative fraction of those changes depending on the pH. And the pH changes the more carbon dioxide you put in. And this graph here shows the relative amounts of these three forms, and it changes with the pH, the acidity of the ocean. Now, of course, with pH, 7 is neutral, sort of 2 is really, really acidic, and 14 is very, very basic. And the ocean at any given time at the moment is about 8, so it's a base, and it will never go acidic. So the ocean acidification is a misnomer, if ever there was one. It turns out that seawater at the moment is roughly about pH 8, and most of this carbon dioxide is in the form of the bicarbonate ion. 90% of the sort of like the carbon dioxide is in the bicarbonate ion. 10% is in the carbonate ion, and almost none is actually in dissolved CO2 molecules. Now, when the CO2 reacts with the water, it also changes the pH. So the pH might go down to, say, 7.9. And what happens then is that the relative proportion of the carbonate goes down. And that could be bad for corals and coccolithophores because, after all, a calcium carbonate skeleton is made of calcium and carbonate. You add a carbonate ion and a calcium ion and you get calcium carbonate. So if you reduce the carbonate, that's going to be a problem for the corals. It seemed plausible. I've been reading this for 20 years and it seemed to make a lot of sense. But it turns out that there is a huge problem. I think it's been known for a while, but it's certainly coming out more and more in the literature. And that is that the corals don't actually calcify out in the ocean. They calcify deep inside the organism in a place called the extracellular calcium medium, calcifying medium. And so they have to import this carbon dioxide in one of its three forms into the coral. And it turns out they don't use the carbonate at all. They use the bicarbonate, which is 10 times more of it anyway, which is probably the reason why they've always used it. So what happens to the amount of bicarbonate with increasing atmospheric carbon dioxide levels? Well, it goes up. So essentially this whole argument that falling carbonate concentrations will stop the coral forming calcium carbonate doesn't work because the coral doesn't use the carbonate directly anyway. Now, it turns out that, you know, this has been known for about a decade. So for example, there's a guy called Kyronek who stated, lines of research in different organisms and ecosystems are beginning to reach the same conclusion. The external seawater omega, that's the amount of carbonate in the ocean, is not what drives calcification. It's actually the bicarbonate ion. So this kind of pretty well blows away the whole ocean acidification catastrophe argument. But actually, it doesn't quite, because there is another argument that is often used. So there's this guy, Jochiel, who points out that, yeah, they're not using carbonate. But this other worry is the problem of the coral trying to get rid of the hydrogen ions it generates internally. So the problem goes like this, that the calcification process deep inside the coral, which actually is carbonate and calcium, it actually produces extra protons or hydrogen ions, and the coral then has to get rid of those. And the problem is that the amount of hydrogen ions in the ocean is more than the number of hydrogen ions in the coral. So it's like pushing something uphill, energetically uphill. So there is now an energy cost to the calcification process. And if there's more hydrogen ions out in the ocean, then you're trying to push the hydrogen ions up a steeper energy hill. And that's bad because, you know, energy is finite. If you have to use energy for one thing, you can't use it somewhere else. But it's interesting that when you read this argument, they almost never put a number on it. So for example, look at this one by Cohen and Holcomb. Calcification is energetically costly and the energy budget is not that flexible. Well, actually, that's not even right, but this isn't even my main point. The calcification is energetically very, very cheap and they do have a flexible energy budget, but that's not what I'm worried about. A coral building a normal skeleton under elevated carbon dioxide condition would have to divert more energy to pumping protons, that's hydrogen ions, from the calcifying fluid than a coral building a normal skeleton under ambient carbon dioxide conditions. But, you know, that's pretty useless because, well, it's got to do more. I'll buy that. But is it sort of like 50% more? Is it, which is big deal, or is it 1% more where we don't have to worry about it? Well, you guessed it, that the research that's coming out now is showing it's pretty small. So Spaulding says, look, it might be just a few percent. The way they do it is that they reckon that the extra cost of calcification might go up by 10%, but calcification is only about 15% of the total energy budget of the coral, so the net energy increase is only about 10%, or 15% is 1.5%. You don't have to worry about that. That's nothing. Or these guys, Willard, who reckon there's basically no energy extra. And the interesting thing about that paper and others is that they don't say in the title or the abstract, hey guys, we've found that there's almost no extra energy, that the corals are going to be fine. You have to really dig deep into these papers to see it. In some cases, right into the supplementary information, which is up on some obscure website somewhere. So in this paper, it says, and this probably won't mean a lot, and that's the whole point. However, when the pH of the ECM, that's the calcifying medium, is equal to 8.5, the calcification cost remains close to 1.4 moles of ATP for 1 mole of calcium carbonate. Now, ATP is like fuel for the coral. It's like petrol. And the fuel consumption is how much of it needs to, of that fuel, it needs to make a bit of calcium carbonate. And they're saying it stays the same, indicating that the two increase at the same pace, right? Or later on, it says, the model demonstrates that ocean acidification increases the calcification rate when this calcium ATP pays, additional energy requirements are not met and the ECM acidifies. So essentially what they're trying to say there in a very abstruse way is it doesn't make any difference to the energy consumption. So the argument about the extra energy getting rid of the hydrogen ions doesn't stack up. And neither does the problem of the lack of carbonate ions, because they use the bicarbonate. Now, actually, there's not just one problem, there's two problems. And that is that, well, the coral is an animal. It produces carbon dioxide itself. Now, some of that carbon dioxide, it circulates back through the little plant organism, which is then used for photosynthesis and then gives the coral animal some energy. But a lot of that carbon dioxide actually ends up going into the calcification. So, for example, this paper says the major source of dissolved inorganic carbon is metabolic CO2. Metabolic CO2 is the stuff that the animal produces by metabolism, while only 25 to 30% originates from the external medium, the seawater carbon pool. So there you have it again, and this has been known for a long, long time, that the external carbonate concentration is pretty well irrelevant. Now, before we finish, I want to give a big thanks to our new channel members. We've sort of gone public with this YouTube channel. We've started a membership. If you want to join, please do. As many of you know, I work for free, but we've got Leonard here, who does all the invaluable research on koalas and things. But, you know, there are costs. And the more that we can get this channel going, the better. Think of all, if we can get it to a whole bunch of very depressed students who all, you know, young people who think that the coral reefs are all dissolving, that's one less child who's not depressed. And that's got to be a good thing, hasn't it? But there is one final thing about the corals, which I want to talk about, and that is that they are, this is another reason why you shouldn't worry about them too much, is that corals turn out to be incredibly adept at managing their internal pH, just like you are. Different parts of you will have different pH. So if you look at this diagram here by these guys, Venn et al., it turns out that the area around the little symbiotic algae, which is inside the coral, has a pH down to 4. Now, that is very, very acidic, considering this is inside the organism. And they're also able to maintain at a very constant level this pH of the extracellular calcifying medium. I did very well saying that, I thought. Anyway, I should also mention that the pH of the seawater in the ocean changes quite dramatically, just from one during the day-night cycle. 0.4 units is quite common, and up to 0.7. And that is way more than actually is going to happen in the next 100 years with all the extra carbon dioxide plant food which we're putting into the atmosphere. So, look, I think it's phenomenal news. As I mentioned, that I was always a little bit worried about it. In fact, in my book, I actually said this was the only thing that worried me. And now I'm not.